My darling, Yeah. Asa ko wale, and embraced him, and said, "He was once lost, but now he is found." So sinner, go back home, and heaven will rejoice over you.
Sinners, remember, oh, sinners, remember, oh, sinners, remember, oh, sinners, remember, oh, Jesus is waiting for you, sinners, remember, oh, sinners, remember, oh, sinners, remember, oh. Thank you, Father, because you know you have answered us, for in Jesus' mighty name we pray. I welcome you all to yet another night of discovery, where we go deep into the Word of God, the Bible. You will notice that we have been going through the book of Matthew for some time now. And we have been learning a lot from it. We learned last time about the worries of John the Baptist and how Jesus deal with his situations. And then we now learn about the importance of making heaven. Today we are going to continue from where we stopped. We are still in Matthew chapter 11. Today we are going to start from verse 16 to verse 24. Matthew chapter 11, verse 16 to 24. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the market, and calling unto their fellow, and saying, "We have fight unto you, and ye have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and ye have not lamented." For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they said, "Behold, a man gluttonous and a wine piper, a friend of publicans and sinners." But wisdom is justified of our children. Verse 20. Then began he to upbraid the city, wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Woe unto thee, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon without companion, which are exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee have been done in Sodom, it would have remained unto this day. But I say unto you, that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment, the people that are not believing his word. Look at the topic. Jesus condemns unbelief. That's the topic we're looking at today. Jesus condemns unbelief. We're going to look at starting from verse 16 where we have read. He said, but whereunto shall I liken this generation? It's like unto children sitting in the market and calling unto their fellow and saying, we have fight unto you and you have not danced, we have mourned unto you and you have not lamented. The people, the Pharisees, their lack of interest in the gospel of Christ. That they refuse to hear the gospel that Christ is preaching, that he is preaching to them. Said he said them that whatever they heard, they are not taking it towards seriously. And it's also illustrating their lack of interest in the things of God, in the gospel of God. Let's look at Luke chapter 7, verse 30. Luke chapter 7, verse 30. But the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the counsel of God. They gave themselves, be not baptized of him. Reject the what? The gospel of what? Of Christ. Because of their unbelief. Not wanting to believe in Jesus. That is what Joshua is trying to say there. That's the meaning of what he's trying to tell them there. Put it in form of a parable, but he's telling them that as he's telling them his word, they are not taking his word seriously. They lack interest in the gospel of God of Christ. And Jesus condemns it. Unbelief. Jesus condemns anyone that refuses to believe on his word. Let's look at verse 18. Of that same verse. Chapter 11, verse 18. For John came, neither eating nor drinking, and they said he had a devil. The Son of Man came, eating and drinking, and they said, behold, a man glutinous and a wine viper, a friend of publicans and sinners, but wisdom is justified of God. He came and preached to them. They refused to what? To take to the word of God of God. They refused to take to the message of God. And when Jesus Christ himself came and preached to them also, they still refused to what? To take to his word, to his teachings. Why? Because they justify themselves that what they are doing is right and what Jesus is doing is what is wrong. They reject the truth of the word of God. This is why their heart is adamant to listen and to take to the word of God. But if you and I, as we hear the truth of the word of God, are we taking it seriously? Seriously, as we hear the word of God, and the word of God didn't preach to us, or we read the word of God, do we take it seriously, or we reject the word? The Pharisees and the Sadducees here. They had John preach and he gave the excuse. They had Jesus preach and they were not taking him seriously. Question you ask yourself, are you like these Pharisees and these Sadducees that refuse to listen to the word of God? Are we like that, that when we hear the truth, we are not really taking it to it, making sure we practice it exactly as we have heard? Let's look at Proverbs chapter 23. By the truth and said it known. Also wisdom and instruction and faith. That as we hear the word of God, we should take it and also what apply it. When they say by the truth and said it, that means that as we hear the truth of the word of God, don't throw it away. Make good use of it. It's also said wisdom and instruction and understanding. Everything we hear about God and see what God has counseled us about, we must take it seriously and make sure we make good use of them. As soon as we are hearing the word of God, what are we making use of it for? Are we using it correctly, exactly as Jesus Christ has advised us? So today, as we are hearing the word of God, what we do, we take it very seriously. We don't hear it in one ear and it goes out to the other ear. We must make use of the word of God exactly as the word of God says it should do. We must not look being like this, the Pharisees, as I just read, that had John preached about repentance and they rejected it. Jesus Christ came and preached to them, they too also rejected him. And that is why the Bible says, according to you, that the truth is what you should buy and hold on to the word, to the truth. We must not reject the truth because nothing can go against the truth. Every time we hear the word of God, read the word of God, and we see something that corrects our life, we must take it and then apply it in our lives. Not doing it will lead to our own destruction. And that's what just can represent the truth. That is why he came to teach us the truth. We must take it and make good use of it. We must not follow this Pharisee, the Sadducee, that rejected the truth of the word of God. They rejected the word of God will lead to their own word, to their own truth. Today, you and I are hearing the word of God. Let's make good use of them. So that we can prosper in life and in life after now. It's only the truth of the word of God that can save you and what? Me. You will see that in that verse 19, I read it again. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and he said, behold, a man of good tonus and a wine viper, a friend of publicans and of sinners, but wisdom is justified of our children. Say, but wisdom is justified of our children. You see that John the Baptist will just come and preach to them and go back to the wilderness. Why? He don't want to belong. He don't want to be like what? Like them. But Jesus, when he comes, he goes to them, goes to their home and begin to preach to them. That is wisdom. kingdom of Jesus
relating
to them, because he came for the sinners, not for the world, for the righteous. Let's look at Matthew chapter 9, verses 10 to 13. Matthew chapter 9,
verses
10 to 13. And it came to pass that Jesus sat at the meat in the house. Behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and the disciples. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto his disciples, Why eateth your master with the publicans and sinners? But when Jesus heard it, he said unto them, They that behold need not a physician, but they that are sick. But go ye and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, for sinners. For sinners, not for the world, for the righteous. John the Baptist came, separated himself from them, he came and preached and separated them, he refused to listen. And when Jesus Christ came, he related with them, they still refused to what? To listen. They rejected the truth of the word of God. They refused to listen and then get the message of Jesus. Because of their unbelief, because of their hardness of heart. Today, as you are hearing the word of God, are you adding? Are you taking the word of God seriously? As you read the word of God today, as you read the word of God, are you making good use of them? Let's not be like this public. And when Jesus Christ came, preached to them, they rejected him. Jesus also came, they also rejected his message. One refuses to believe in the name of Jesus or the gospel of Jesus. In verse 20, back to that verse, chapter 11. Then began he to upbraid the city wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Going about, making sure they hear the word of what? Hear the word of God. The truth about matter, what justice is illustrating here is that the more light we give, the more gospel we preach to the world, the more excuse they will give for what? For the lesser excuse they will give for what? For their sinning. That tells you that Jesus knows the importance of going out to preach the gospel to all creatures. That's what he said. Then began he to unbreak the city. That is to say, go out and begin to preach to them so that they can know the truth by God preaching. Going out to preach the word of God to everyone, they will not give excuse of their word sin any longer. There will not be any excuse why they should not all repent, why they are suffering. There will not be any excuse any longer because they have heard of the truth of the word of God. The reason why a lot of people are giving excuse is maybe they have not heard about the word of God. So it is very important that we go out and preach Christ to every creature. Jesus Christ also encouraged us to do that.
Yes,
men that believe should go out and also preach Christ to the whole world. Why? So that they can repent and come back to Jesus. Let's look at Mark chapter
16.
Mark chapter
16.
Verse 15 and 16. Chapter
16,
verses 15 and 16. And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. Jesus said, not tell you that by force they must repent. He said, just go out and preach the gospel to every creature. Those that believe, they will be baptized. That those that refuse to believe, they will be damned.
Yes, yes, yes.
That says there's no excuse why we should not preach Christ to the world. Because if we refuse to preach, they will not be what? They will not be saved.
That's why
Jesus Christ encouraged every believer, every true child of God, to make sure he goes out and preach Christ to every creature. So that they will not perish in their sin, their evil. And that's what Jesus did in that verse, in that Matthew chapter 11, verses 20, and we read.
He don't
want them to give any excuse why they should not what? They should not repent, why they should justify their sin. No one was going all about the city preaching to what, to death, so that they will know that this thing they are doing is evil. And that's the great commission Jesus Christ has given to every true child of God, going out to preach Christ to the world, so that the world can be what, can be saved. In also in Matthew chapter 28:18-20. Jesus also commanded us to also do that. That going to go out and walk and preach Christ to the whole world. Matthew chapter 28:18-20. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end. The world being saved, or the brother of the sinner coming back to what, to him. That is why he went and he preached to the people, encouraging us as believers to do the
same.
So you and I must do that, go out and preach Christ so that people can be saved. But after Jesus Christ preached to them, when he went out to preach to them with all the signs and all the wonders he did in their land, they still did not walk, they still did not
believe.
He said, in that verse 20, I can go back there again. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 20. Then began he to upbraid the city, wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Even miracle, judgment, will not allow that person to what? To repent. God will not allow one situation to look like that, whereby we are so adamant that repentance is no good area in our lives. Let's look at Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. 27-31. Luke chapter 16. 27 to 31. Luke chapter 16. 27-31. Then he said, I pray thee, wherefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophet, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophet, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the
dead.
When both of them died, Lazarus went to heaven and stayed under the bosom of Abraham.
But
when the rich man died, he went to hell because of the evil he did. When he knew that he was suffering where he is, he told Father Abraham to tell to send Lazarus to the world to preach to his brothers, his five brothers, that are in the world. But Abraham told him, they have Moses, they have what? They have the prophet, that the prophet will preach to them and they will listen. But he said, no, if one, the rich man here, he was telling them, Abraham, no, if one from the dead raise and go back to them, they will believe. And he began to cry, that if they will not listen to Moses, will not listen to the prophet, neither will they listen to anyone that is dead and rose and come back to what to preach to them. Why would they not listen? Because of their hardiness of what? Of
hard.
When one heart is hardy, the word of God will not take it seriously. Let's look at Revelation chapter 9, verses 20 to 21. Revelation chapter 9. Verses 20 to 21. And the rest of the men which were not killed by this plague, yet repented not of the work of their hand, that they should not worship devil, and idol of gold and silver, and brass and stone, and of wood, which neither can see, nor hear, nor walk. Neither repent they of their murder, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. To give their ear, give their heart to the word of God, to the word of God. Who refuse to what? To accept Jesus, to accept God. Their heart is hardened to worship Satan. Is adding heart. And there is danger when one has that adding heart, the heart that will not what, want to take the word of God seriously, or that want to what, to repent from this or an evil. Let's look at Proverbs chapter 29, verse 1. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 1. Being often reproved, adding his name shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. The word of God, you still keep on adding your heart to come to Jesus, to accept his word. It will get to a time, one will be destroyed, and there will not be any remedy. Why? Because of addingness of word of heart. A heart of unbelief. And that's what Jesus condemned. Jesus rejects what? Unbelief. Anyone that has hardness of heart will be destroyed one day if or she refuses to repent. So must run from every hardened heart. We must pray fully. Tell God to remove every adding heart in our lives. That is why we are praying that God remove every heart of stone from me. Because an heart of stone, a hardened heart, will not want to take the word of God seriously. Let's look at other people that refuse to worship the king of God. They are doing the wrong thing. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 15 to 18. Deuteronomy chapter 32, verses 15 to 18. But Jeshurun was fast and keep down. Thou art once in fat, thou art grown thick, thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. They provoked him to jealousy with strange God, with abomination, provoked they him to anger. They sacrificed unto devil, not to God, the gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your father feared not, of the rock that beget thee, thou art unmindful and hast forgotten God. That was to what? To serve God, for serving was Satan. Instead of worshiping God, they are worshiping Satan, and they keep on worshiping because their heart is what? Heart pain. That tells you and I there is danger if your heart is hardened to repent, hardened to forgive, hardened to reconcile with your word, with your God. This one, they have had the word of God with all the miracles he did and all the preaching he preached. They still had in their hand because they have an hand in hand. Our should not be like that.
You
must not have this hand in hand where you refuse the word of God. Where we refuse the counsel of God, receive the word, admonition of God. Let's look at also the warning against what? Unbelief. Unbelief is a serious sin, a serious evil in the sight of God. Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3. I'll start from verse 7. Hebrews chapter 6. Start from verse 7. Wherefore, as the Holy Ghost said, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation, in the day of temptation, in the wilderness. Talking to you and me, yeah. He did not say tomorrow, he said today. As you hear the word of God, harden not your word, your heart. That's what he said, harden not your heart. Danger if one adding his heart to the word of God. Being perished, being destroyed at the end of the day. Let's look at verse 10. That's in Hebrews chapter 3. Wherefore I was grieved with that generation and said, they do always err in their heart, and they have not known my way. So I have sworn in my wrath, they shall not enter into my day. And those that always err, those that always what? Go away from listening to the word of God, not doing and practicing the word of God, what will happen is that they will not enter into his rest. anyone that refuses to know the way of Jesus and put it into what? To practice. Because of unbelief, because of hardness of heart, they will not enter into the rest of God. In verse 12, look at the counsel they gave us there.
They
say, take it, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil act of unbelief in departing from the living God. Can you see the counsel there? Departing from the living God. That's what he's canceling us. That we must be very careful not to use this act of what unbelief to depart from what? From the presence of God. What is unbelief? Any act, only what just kind of told you and you're not putting it to practice is an act of what? Unbelief. Every word of God that we are giving and we are not taking it seriously, it's an act of what? Unbelief. And they are danger for what? For
real.
As if that's not enough, in verse 15, it is cancel us on that also. That is the Holy Spirit teaching us, warning us here. So why it is said, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation. It's not important. The Holy Spirit will not have repeated it twice. He says it again. Today, hear the word of God, harden not your heart. Should take it seriously. Don't say it does not matter. It matters. Don't say that this one is little. It doesn't matter. It matters. Everything about the word of God matters. When I look stupid in your word, in your subconscious, it what? It matters. So we must take the word of God seriously. And do it. Refusing to do the word of God, refusing to do the will of God, is an act of unbelief. And a danger for
really.
We are one of the danger that it will lead to our own destruction. Even in the Latin, when just comes, anyone that refuses to what? To believe, definitely will find himself to blame. Let's look at Revelation chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21. Verse 8. Revelation chapter 21. Verse 8. So for the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderer and whoremongers and sorcerers and adulators and all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. See that now? Any unbelieving person will find himself a lake of fire at the end of the day. Especially if he or she refuses to want to repent. The one that Jesus condemns what? Unbelief. Because he knows that anyone that refuses to believe in him, believe in his way, and refuses to believe and repent, at the end of the day, will find himself in hell. That's the passage given to us, even in the last day. That is another danger of unbelief. If you refuse to believe in Jesus, then at the end of the day, if you refuse to repent and believe in Jesus, you find yourself in hell. That's what they're telling us there. That is so important for Jesus to warn us to this extent. The act of unbelieving. Some of us say, I believe in what? I believe in Jesus. Are you doing what he asks you to do? You say, I'm a Christian. Are you doing what exactly he told you to do? If you refuse to do what he asks you to do, that's an act of unbelief. That is what he's warning us in his word. You should not follow, as I said earlier on, this Pharisees and the Sadducees who heard the word of God, but their heart was not there. They refused to believe John, they refused to John the Baptist, they refused to believe Jesus also. Even with all the miracles that Jesus Christ did in their own world, they, in their own land, in their own country, they still refused to believe in him. They have an unbelieving heart. Let's look at John. John chapter 3. Verses 15 to 16. That whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Refuse to believe in his way, we end up in hell. We end up being perished. Look at verse 18 also. Said, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he had not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Can you sit that down? Anyone that refuses to believe in Jesus, he or she at that stage, at that point in time, is condemned already. Because he refused to believe in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Because he or she have an adding heart and unbelief in his life. We can see where Jesus is condemning him here. Condemning what? Any act of what? Unbelief. He said, but unless you believe, that is when you can have everlasting life. So any act of behavior whereby we are not obeying or doing what Jesus asked us to do, we should correct ourselves, because that might be an act of unbelief. Let's look at some of the blessings when one believes in Jesus. John chapter 1 verse 12. John chapter 1 verse 12. Say, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the Son of God, even to them that believe on his name. Jesus, as men that believe on him, they become the what? The sons and daughters of what? Of God. blessing, we keep on looking and acting to the word of what? God. Listen to the word of God, practicing the word of God. You should not believe on any other thing, but on the name of God, on the work of God, on the word of God. Let's look at another one in John chapter 20, verse 29. John chapter 20, verse 29. Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed, blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed.
Yes.
Believe in Jesus. Where one look at his word, hear his word, and he's doing them. So Jesus Christ is calling us today that as we hear the word of
from doctrine to system. Behold, thou hast died me out of this world from the presence of death, and from thy presence of shall I be high, and I shall be in poverty and vagabond to death, and it shall come to pass that every one that findeth me shall slay me, and the Lord said unto him, therefore, whoso hath slain Cain, the man shall be taken from him sevenfold. And the Lord set mark upon Cain, and lest any find him high. There is a certain man named Ananias, who set by his wife, sold a possession, and kept by part of the price. His wife also did, having to him, and brought the certain part, and laid it for him.
Yes, that's a true contradiction there. Now, in the case of Cain, you know when God told him, where is your brother? He told God, am I my brother's keeper? That shows some irresponsibility in the heart of what? Of Cain. And God had to curse him for that.
If
God cursed him and he saw the punishment that will come upon him, there's in effect a sum of what? A remorse. And no, through that process, we ask God, have mercy upon what? Have mercy upon me. In fact, his speech that he made, that verse you just read, so that he's telling God that, Lord, have mercy upon this punishment is what? It's too much for me to what? To bear. When God saw that, and he now said that, it's better for people to what? To kill him. At the end of the day, he will be killed. God had to put him out there. You will not be killed. You only suffer your what? The punishment. Yes, God did not kill him.
No, God did not.
But his punishment that God punished him is worse than someone that he killed. A fugitive.
I'm married to
you. You know, walking all about, aimlessly, like that, without aim, no left or right, nothing. You're not looking. That is his word that we will what? Get himself. But one thing you must know, God has judgment for everyone, every case. And God knows the judgment he will give to one, and the judgment will give to what? To another. Our God is not a one-way person. He's a different person. He's a mysterious God being. He's a mysterious person.
He's
somebody you cannot understand completely. If you take an action here, it will take another action here. And both actions are justifiable. In the after of Cain, he refused to kill Cain, yes. But to punish him to suffer in the earth. And he actually suffered. Why? Because he went out from the presence of God. If one goes out of the presence of God, of course, the devil will take over and he will suffer for it. In the case of Sapphira and Ananias, I must tell you, they must have been committing some little sin, and God has been warning them. But they still refuse to what? To hear. But when we commit this one, let's go back to that. In Acts of Apostles chapter 5, verse 1. But a certain man named Ananias, which is Sapphira's wife, sold the possession and kept back part of the price. His wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said unto Ananias, why has Satan filled their heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep part of the price of the land? That they must have been doing other evil, and God has been having mercy upon what? Upon them. What you must know, the mercy of God will come to an end in one's life if one refuses to what? To repent. If one dies, the mercy of God ends in that person's what? That person's life. There's no mercy of God in the grave. But this person, Sapphira, they lie against the word, they lie to the word of the Holy Spirit. God must have known that if this one is allowed, it will cause a lot of problems in their ministry, in the work of God, in the work of God. No wonder when Ananias fell and what and died, great fear came on everyone that saw that event. And it will be a lesson for them to know that to lie against the Holy Spirit is very, very dangerous. No wonder the Bible says, grieve not the Spirit. For this one, they grieve the Holy Spirit, even though they have everything to themselves. But why lying when everything? You can tell them, we are chosen and so, and we are giving this one and keeping this one for ourselves. That tells you that every of our gift, our offering that we give, that as lying it, God will not what? God will not accept it. If you look at downward, you see that after this thing, you see that the church keep on what? Keep on growing. Let's look at verse 14. And believers, we are the more added to the Lord, multitude, both men and the great day. They saw, they see the display of the Holy Spirit, killing, God killing here. They were afraid, and more people begin to believe in God, and were added to the word of the church.
So that's how I say by you don't share it. I'll take you and I want to allow the girl as you know to be full of all of us.
So it's not prerogative to either kill or to make war, to make a lie. God has punishment for everyone, for everyone.
promise of
God. The God will give to this person is not the same point that God will give to that word, to that person. Sometimes God cannot have mercy on somebody and not have mercy on the other person.
You
say, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy upon. And I cannot question. Whatever he does is right. So in this sense, God wants to keep Cain to suffer his punishment. In this sense, Satan and that he wants to kill them for them to go to hell straight. In both cases, we should not be involved in both cases of what Cain and Ananias. Because if both of them greet God, they greet the Holy Spirit. They suffer for what? They suffer for rain. Because Ananias had a life and the other person killed his brother. That's your time to that you and I must bear this our goal. I can kill, I can also make what? Alive. That is God for you. You must bear him every day of our lives. I'm not seeing any other hands. Let's rise up as we pray. There's no any question. We're going to pray and tell God. Lord, help my unbelief. Anyway, I've displayed an act of unbelief.